the world most honored watch is Longines.
Longines watches have won 10 World's Fair grand prizes, 28 gold medals, and more honors for accuracy than any other timepiece. Longines, the world's most honored watch, is made and guaranteed by the Longines Whitnall Watch Company.
It's time for the Longines Chronoscope, a television journal of the important issues of the hour, brought to you every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. A presentation of the Longines Whitnall Watch Company, maker of Longines, the world's most honored watch, and Whitnall, distinguished companion to the world-honored Longines.
Good evening. This is Frank Knight. May I introduce our co-editors for this edition of the Longines Chronoscope? Mr. William Bradford Huie, editor of the American Mercury, and Mr. Donald I. Rogers, an editor of the New York Herald Tribune. Our distinguished guest for this evening is Dr. Nicholas Nyaradi, former Hungarian Minister of Finance. The opinions expressed are necessarily those of the speakers.
Dr. Nyaradi, since you were Minister of Finance in Hungary before the Communists took over, and have spent some time in Moscow and behind the Iron Curtain as an official of Hungary, we'd like to have you tell us some of the intimate things you learned behind the Iron Curtain. And we'd like to have you perhaps start our show by telling us about the effectiveness of our own propaganda program. How effective, for instance, is the Voice of America?
The great difficulty for every broadcast which comes from the free world is to penetrate Russia. And there are two great walls, iron walls, to this penetration. The first is of a technical nature. The other is of a psychological one. The technical nature, of course, is that you have to know that in the whole huge Russian empire, may I say so, there are not more than 2 million radio sets which you could control or which you can get any foreign broadcast.
How many people?
220 million people about now.
And who owns these radio sets?
I don't think I have to tell you that there are the special caste of high-ranking communists, and even they can get those foreign broadcasts due to the fact that 80% of those are carefully jammed by the Russian government transmitters. So here you have a situation when the people itself is deaf to any voice coming from the West.
All that we lack is an audience for the Voice of America.
Well, for any Western broadcast, exactly. And the other is, of course, of a difficulty of psychological nature, to answer your question, Mr. Rogers.
To those who do listen, you mean?
To those, no, to if even they could listen, even if we would have 200 million sets of radio sets in Russia, the Russian people would not understand what we tell them because their mentality, their background, their experiences, their education is completely different. To tell today a Russian about the American way of life, about our concepts of freedom and democracy,
they don't believe it.
It's exactly the same as if you would tell a man who was born blind that what is the difference between light blue and dark blue. They don't believe it. They don't believe it, they can't grasp it. Simply.
Well, is there anything we can do then? Since the voice is ineffective, what propaganda measures can we take?
Well, Mr. Rogers, there was a very old and I think very good idea, the idea of sending balloons over there. And those balloons would drop leaflets and the people could read those leaflets, look at the pictures. This would naturally one step forward. But what I pointed out in this book of mine was that even this isn't enough. Because due to this special indoctrination of the Russian people, what they would appreciate would be the quality of the paper. And this would be about all, because they would think that all the other are the messages of the American Ministry of Propaganda. They believe that such a nonsense exists.
In other words, it's the tangible things that they pay attention to.
Exactly. Now, this is what I point out, that those leaflets should be accompanied by a shower of cheap gifts, of dime store gadgets, razor blades, soap, cigarettes, chocolate bars, shaving cream, and many other things.
Are these things they don't have in Russia today?
Partially they don't have them, and partially they have it in a much worse quality that we have over here. And now, naturally, you must know that the Kremlin's propaganda tells them that you people here in America are downtrodden slaves of capitalism, that you have no shoes, that you have no clothing, that you are hungry all the time. Yeah. Now imagine those Russians picking up those superior things which would shower down on them from those free balloons and begin to look at them. To wash with this soap, which is so much better as the Russian soap, to go ahead and shave with this American razor blade, which is 1,000 times better than this terrible Russian razor blade. You know, what we could plant in their minds is a doubt towards their own government, because when they would see those miraculous gadgets, they would begin to doubt that everything what they hear about America, our aggressiveness, our capitalism, our exploitation, they would begin to see that it is a lie. We could bring our truth to this very simple way and combat with it the great lie.
You mean you're telling us, Doctor, that perhaps the best way we can prove the superiority of our culture is to show them that we have a superior brand of soap?
Well, it's very difficult to prove them a superior brand of culture, because they were told that there is no superior brand of culture than the communist culture is. But if we show them our soap, they might doubt also about their superiority of their culture.
You think soap is a more effective weapon than ideas, then?
If you would know, Mr. Huie, how important soap is in Russia today, you certainly would
admit that. Are they interested in culture? Do they pay any attention to the cultural things of life?
They do pay a great attention, but this is also played up in the present communist regime.
Yes.
You see, they give the Stalin prizes for what they call culture, but it is only communist propaganda. It's no culture, finally and deeply.
Yeah. Oh, Doctor, you're, of course, on Hungarian, and Hungary has many American friends. I'm sure that some of our audience would like you to tell us tonight if a great cultural city like Budapest is likely to be changed drastically, or perhaps to be destroyed as a cultural center. What's happening to Budapest today under the occupation?
I have witnessed first the physical destruction of Budapest by the Soviet troops and the Nazis. And then today we have to witness, naturally from here, from distance, the cultural destruction, which I would call cultural genocide. It's what's going on now to kill in our youth, in our people, the feeling of nationalism, the feeling of loving their country. Because how our youth is brought up today, unfortunately, is in the love for Stalin, the alleged great teacher of mankind. And today the children are taught of hating their parents, of hating religion, of hating their home, and to die one day for the great leader.
This is effective among the children?
Well, I'm sorry to tell you that we in Hungary, we have shown in two elections under Russian occupation that we do not want communism. The anti-communist parties in Hungary got 83% of the votes in spite of the Russian pressure. The anti-communist,
yes.
That's right. But you see, the children, they have soft minds. You know, you can mold the minds, unfortunately. You can even bribe them. And today they are taught this way. And this is the greatest disaster for the future of any of those, I wouldn't say satellite, but captive nations.
You're saying, sir, that within a period of a generation, a nation like Hungary can disappear as a cultural entity.
Not only as a cultural entity, but I am afraid that it might disappear as a national entity, or perhaps even as a racial entity. We have suffered so many invasions during our 1,000-year-old history, but no one went down to the grassroots of national existence to the extent as the communist Soviet occupation does.
How long do we of the West have, would you say, to rescue a nation like Hungary?
You know, it is very difficult to answer you this question, Mr. Huie. We political exiles, we are always accused that we want you Americans to fight our war. So I mustn't tell you how our people suffer. But I can tell you one thing, that due to this terribly effective Soviet educational system, if those countries could be liberated today, it would mean that the 80% of the people would fight tooth and nail the Russians.
You imply that time is not in our favor, as we've been led to believe.
In this sector, I am sorry to say, time is working against the cause of democracy.
Is that true in these other satellite nations, in Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia?
Well, Yugoslavia has now a different brand of communism, you know, Titoism.
Still so communism, though.
Still and not different at all from Stalinian communism.
About Titoism, sir, a great many Americans place some hope in Titoism. Now, do you place hope in Titoism?
My dear Mr. Huie, if our people would be given the choice to choose what they want to, they do not want any brand of communism, should it Stalinian or Titoist or whatever. They want no communism at all.
They want capitalism.
Well, they want freedom first, and then to decide how they want to live. But they definitely were brought up under a system of free enterprise and individual initiative.
We call that capitalism.
Yes.
All right. Well, now, about this business of freedom, sir, are you telling our audience that there still is a large group of people in Hungary who value personal freedom and who would be willing to fight for it?
I am definitely convinced about it. But under the present circumstances, when the secret police has an incredible and terrible grasp over every single individual, of course, you couldn't expect those people to do something actually for their liberation. It would be suicide.
And you're saying that perhaps if we wait as long as 15 years, that aspiration for freedom and liberty may disappear in large sectors of the Western world?
It might disappear in the sense that more and more of those young people would be thought and would believe the infallibility of the Stalinian, Leninian doctrine.
Well, I'm sure, Dr. Nyaradi, that our audience has very much appreciated this very forthright statement of the conditions that exist in Hungary and behind the Iron Curtain today. Thank you very much for being with us tonight, sir.
The editorial board for this edition of the Longines Chronoscope was Mr. William Bradford Huie and Mr. Donald I. Rogers. Our distinguished guest was Dr. Nicholas Nyaradi, former Hungarian Minister of Finance. When spring comes, in many homes, thoughts turn ahead to the big moment of graduation. And the most wanted graduation gift is a fine watch. And many budding graduates aspire to the world's most honored watch, Longines. For no other watch is so much a symbol of achievement. And why not a Longines? A Longines watch is worth much more than the little more it costs. And after 15, 20, or even 25 years of service, many Longines watches are still worn with pride, are still demonstrating their superiority as timepieces. A Longines watch is a unique gift, a treasured possession, honored for excellence and elegance by 10 World's Fair Grand Prizes and 28 Gold Medal Awards, honored for accuracy by innumerable prizes and bulletins from the great government observatories, honored for honesty in sports, aviation, exploration, and science. Yes, why not a Longines? For a Longines watch is worth much more than the little more it costs. And you may buy and proudly give a Longines watch for as little as $71.50. Longines, the world's most honored graduation watch. Premier product of the Longines Whitnor Watch Company since 1866. Maker of watches of the highest character. We invite you to join us every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday evening at this same time for the Longines Chronoscope, a television journal of the important issues of the hour. Broadcast on behalf of Longines, the world's most honored watch, and Whitnor, a distinguished companion to the world-honored Longines. This is Frank Knight reminding you that Longines and Whitnor watches are sold and serviced from coast to coast by more than 4,000 leading jewelers who proudly display this emblem, Agency for Longines Whitnor Watches. This is the CBS Television Network.